created to stimulate discussion among the college faculty and to offer opportunities for enrichment to students and friends of the college. In 1992, the Dean's Lecture Series was renamed in honor of the late Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who served as the academic dean from 1955 to 1977. The series continues through gifts made by family and friends. Throughout its 34-year history of the series, special emphasis has been given to lecture topics reaching across academic fields. It's traditional that Charlotte Noe joins us tonight because of the cold and concerns about the weather. She decided to play it safe tonight, so she sends her apologies for not being able to join us. Again, tonight it's my privilege to introduce our speaker, Dr. Philip Acree Cavalier. Dr. Cavalier joined the Eureka College community in June 2009 and currently serves as provost and dean. During his 4.5 years at Eureka College, he has guided the college through a series of a successful HLC reaccreditation process that has resulted in a 7-year renewal, the development of a comprehensive first-year experience program, and a detailed college retention plan. He has also created a new artist-in-residence position, initiated a new exchange program with Lingnan University in Hong Kong, and he has instituted sabbatical course release and summer research programs. He was previously a faculty member at Catawba College in North Carolina, where he also held various administrative roles. In 2005, 2006, he and his wife Carol and their 3 sons lived in Kyiv, Ukraine for 10 months, where he was a Fulbright scholar teaching at 2 Ukrainian universities. That experience will provide the fodder for tonight's lecture. Phil received a PhD in English from the University of Buffalo, a Master of Arts in English from Northeastern University, and a Bachelor of Arts degree in economics from Swarthmore College. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Phil Acree Cavalier.
Thank you. If I turn my head away and you don't hear me, just go ahead and throw a hand up or scream out. The nice thing about tonight's lecture or tonight's event is that I feel very much like I'm amongst friends, and so for those of you who are guests to the campus, welcome, but to the rest of you, it's good to be with you to talk about something that I don't think I've had an opportunity to tell you that much about in our faculty meetings or division chair meetings or whatever else we've done for 5 years together. As I was putting this together, the thing that really jumped out at me was I was trying to stitch together 2 things. The experience that we had as a young family in 2005-06, and try to say something that made some sense or at least got you interested or made you aware of what's happening in Ukraine right now, and that what the slide presentation or the PowerPoint presentation turns out to be is actually a very interesting, there's similarities between what I see as the experience in Ukraine and the slideshow, which is to say you start off with pictures, as you'll see, of a very cute family. If you don't think it's cute, please don't tell me, but a very cute little family, and you end up literally with pictures of burnt buses and barricades on Maidan, 2 extremes, and to me that is very much what the experience of being in Ukraine is, that you are confronted constantly with extremes, some of the most beautiful things and the most beautiful people you'll ever be around, and some of the worst things you'll be around. So that was an interesting thing that came out of putting this together. That's the beautiful family, at least in my mind, the beautiful family. I'm going to talk tonight about basically do this in 4 pieces, and I'm going to walk around and I can't be at the microphone for this. I want to talk first about some broad conclusions that I've come to. These are my conclusions. They're not my conclusions as a Slavic studies expert. They're not my conclusions as someone who grew up in Ukraine. They're my conclusions as someone who is a slightly failed traveler to Ukraine who lived there for 10 months and we all muddled along, Carol better than I. But I think they're interesting, to me, conclusions about travel, living abroad for a long period of time, and Ukraine in particular. The second thing I want to do is to describe our life. But I want to start with the conclusions before I talk to you some about the stories that I have. And by the way, if you want to know more stories, stop by my office at any day, because I have plenty. They keep coming back into my head, and I want to tell them, and nobody wants to listen to them, but except for you tonight, because you came to listen to them. The third thing is I want to talk briefly about my experience teaching in Ukraine and lecturing in Ukraine, because it's very different. Even though the first dean that I worked with said that teaching around the world and higher education around the world is exactly the same, and I'll explain why she was so wrong about that and how much I enjoyed my interactions with that dean. Deans are really good people, but she was not a really good person. And then the final thing is I do want to make a few comments about the protests in Ukraine. It's possible some of you don't have a very clear sense of that, though you probably have a very clear sense about Justin Bieber's DUI. And in some ways, that's why this is, I'm glad to have this opportunity, because for just this hour, you'll have the opportunity to hear about Ukraine rather than about some things that seem to preoccupy, if not us, then the people who provide us with the news. So, first, some broad conclusions. I was selected in 2004 to go to Ukraine for a year to teach American literature through the Fulbright Scholars Program. I was very excited about it. Carol was willing to, very adventurous, and said, let's do it. Let's see what happens. I was teaching in North Carolina at that time. I was an associate professor of English there. I was the associate dean there. We were just getting to the end of an accreditation process, so it was a perfect time to leave. It was a perfect time to leave. When I was in Ukraine, I taught at two universities. I taught at Kyiv International University and Kyiv Slavonic, both private universities, both universities that obviously came into, well, maybe not obviously, but they came into being after the Soviet Union collapsed. Private institutions in Ukraine popped up, as they did in other former Soviet countries. Many of them popped up to become moneymakers, or they became kind of scams. These were two of the universities that really did invest and wanted to grow, and they have thrived, both of them, but I had very different experiences at those two. And so the whole family went to Kyiv in August 2005 through London, and we arrived, I'm not going to say much about this now, but we arrived, I think it was the day that Katrina hit. So we did not have any access to internet at that point, and we did not have access to any English TV. And all we saw were literally massive waves and what is USA in Cyrillic on the TV screen, but did not really know what was going on. And you know, for me, that was one of those moments. It was a very, very strange thing to be in that country, and it was even stranger to not know what significant was happening back where we had come from. So we moved, and these pictures are taken on the left. That's on our balcony on our apartment, and on the right, that's in our one-bedroom apartment, which I'll say more about. There's a lot of little people in one small space, and the two of us. I just thought, on the off chance that you did not stop by a map store and take a look at where everything is, it's not the Ukraine, as probably most of you know. It's Ukraine, and it is a very close neighbor of Russia, and there's a very strong connection between Russia and Ukraine. There was an expression that we were told once when somebody was talking about Ukraine-Russia relations, and you know, did people want to be Russian? Did they want to be Ukrainian? And at one point somebody said, look, there are brothers and you can't choose your brothers. So it really doesn't matter if you want to be Ukrainian or Russian, you're sort of part of the same family and you can't pull that apart. To the west, over here by Lviv, this is a much more Ukrainian, nationalist is probably not the right way to put it, but the people who feel strongly about an independent Ukraine, they are in Lviv. There was at some point in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I think it was the Interior Minister of Ukraine said, and BBC picked this up, that the problem that was going on in Ukraine was due to the fact that people from Western Ukraine who were Ukrainians, and they wanted to be Ukrainians, they wanted to be part of the EU, were being parachuted into other cities in Ukraine and stirring up all the trouble. And, you know, said with a straight face. That's what's one of the things that blows your mind when you hear some of the stuff that the interior minister said with a straight face, that these sort of nationalist Ukrainians were being parachuted in around the country, which, of course, leads one to think, why aren't they taking a train or driving? But parachuting, apparently, because most Ukrainian nationalists are parachutists. So this gives you a sense of where Ukraine is. The West also has tremendous, beautiful mountains. The boys and Carol went there to Yuremche, and my middle son Benjamin got drunk on seltzer water there. I think it was that not the case? Do you want to say something about that? Anyway, so on the eastern part, you have a strongly Russian sensibility there. They don't want to be separate. They want to be part of whatever it is that that Russia wants to be or will become. So let me go back to this to stay there. So it was a difficult year. I'll say that very bluntly. What I wanted to believe before we went to Ukraine was that I was a terrific traveler, that I would manage this beautifully, that I would be right-headed in everything, and I'd come back fluent in Ukrainian. And that's not exactly how it all worked out. And truly, for me, one of the disappointing things is that it was so hard for me to be there. I loved it in so many ways, but man, if Carol hadn't been there, I would not have survived, because she was the one who did a lot of the really, really, in my mind, hard and embarrassing things, like being able to say, I don't have any idea how to communicate with you, but need to. I would shut down in those moments, and Carol would persevere. So finding that out about myself was not an easy thing to do. I did not realize how much I took language for granted and the ability to communicate for granted. So that was a realization. And I guess maybe some of you are thinking, well, you don't have to go to Ukraine to figure that out. Actually, I think you do have to go someplace where you get to a point where you're standing there and you want to buy a subway token and you've grown up in New York City and you have no problem with cities. The only problem is, with your PhD, you have no idea how to ask for a subway token. And the person on the other end has no interest in trying to imagine what you might want. Truly, none. If you can't tell me, I'm not going to try and figure it out for you. And in those moments, you know, you just realize I'm educated in one place and completely paralyzed in this other case. And that's a moment of really realizing how much I rely on language and the difficulty of not having them, which then leads to, for me, the realization as a result of this trip. People came to this country. I grew up in New York City. They moved from Italy, and they moved up into Harlem. And they were educated people. They had higher, advanced degrees. And they knew that when they showed up on 125th Street and whatever, to live in an apartment that faced nothing, that they were going to spend the rest of their lives, except in their very small community, not being able to speak and communicate in nuanced and sophisticated ways to other people. That they were, even if they got some language, some English, they were never going to get to the point that they had been when they were back in their home country with an advanced degree. Now, you make your trade-off, you make your changes for certain reasons. I get that. But that was, again, something that I had never really understood well until I was in a position where I realized, boy, if I just stayed here for the rest of my life, there are a lot of people who speak English, but for the rest, I would never get past a very basic competence in speaking with them. And that's a difficult thing to realize. And again, this is one that you could say, well, that's an obvious thing, but you have to realize that people do things differently. And they don't do them the way you would do them. And it's tempting every time you encounter something like that to say, wow, they're so crazy for doing it that way. But that's the wrong attitude. I think for me, and I had that attitude several times. I remember seeing a truck that was being unloaded by hand, bags being unloaded by hand. It was a semi. And I thought, well, surely if you had a forklift, that would go faster. But I don't think the point there was for it to go faster, and I don't think I had really any idea of why that continued to be the way to do things. Now, it may have been the wrong way. The point I'm trying to make is that the way I saw it was, I'm an American, I know efficiency, I know how to do that better. And I needed to get away from that. And I think, you know, I think we all struggled with that all the way through. And you'll hear a couple stories later about moments where you really do say, no, that's really, that seems like not the right way to do it. But and then the last thing, I guess, is that, you know, if you're going to live abroad, which I would, and there are five students here, for the five students who I'm addressing now, you should live abroad. You should not visit abroad. You should live abroad, because it's a very powerful experience. But in doing that, you have to be willing to let go of a lot of things that you believe strongly and realize that things are out of your control. So, for example, it became apparent on the trip from the airport into Kyiv, our first day, that our way of understanding how you strap infants into a car, that was not going to work, because there weren't a lot of car seats around. In fact, were there even seat belts in that van? We didn't even have seat belts in the van that brought us in. So for those of you who know Silas, imagine Silas-sized child, that was Elijah at that point, you know, on your lap, being carried, going 70 miles an hour down the road, and thinking, there are two options here. You know, we go home, we demand only to move about in the way that Americans would, which means we're going to go pretty much nowhere, or we say, okay, this is the cost, or this is the gamble that we have to take, this is the risk we have to take for having this experience. And again, that's hard to do, especially when you're going up a road, up a mountain, up behind Yalta, up I Petri, and it's a, you know, curvy hairpin turns, and everyone's getting ready to be sick, and Carol's in the front, and she's got Elijah, and right at the windshield. That's not how any of us would travel now, but if you're going to go see I Petri in Ukraine, then that's the way you're going to have to do it. So all those things, I think, and others, were important. They were things I came away understanding that I didn't know before. So why did we choose Ukraine? Well, let me say that it wasn't we. I think it's possible Carol would have chosen something a little bit more moderate in climate and not quite as deathly gray in the winter. But I had taught a book in a Utopias course that I taught called Magnetic Mountain by a historian named Stephen Kotkin. And it was a story of the creation of Magnitogorsk in Russia. And the story was about how that Stalin had used that as an opportunity to build a perfect socialist city. Now, for whatever reason, that book really piqued my interest about the Soviet Union, and I was really interested to know what the post-Soviet world looked like. So that book really kind of made me decide Ukraine. We also had a chance to go to Belarus, which at the time I didn't realize what a bad idea that would have been. And I think there was a moment where we thought, yeah, we could go to Belarus. That wouldn't be such a bad thing, except it would have been an awful thing. So anyway, let me talk a little bit about our experiences in our apartment and some of the things the boys experienced. But let me start by saying this. The first morning that we were in Ukraine, I realized things were going to be very, very hard when Toby and I went down to Bezerovka, around the corner here. And Bezerovka is this, it's a market on the main drag, right near the center of Kyiv. It's a big indoor open market. And I put this up to give you a sense. There's stalls like this all the way through. There's vegetables and fruits and, you know, all kinds of things. So Toby and I went in to get some water, because you can't drink the water in Kyiv. It's not good, especially if you're not from there. So we went to get some water. And didn't have any idea what to say or any of the rest of that, but, you know, pointing and giving money, and we wound up bringing back two bottles of something. Got upstairs, twisted the cap, and carbonation. So it was seltzer water. And now, that doesn't seem like very much, except, you know, when you have a little tiny family with you, you've got 10 months to be in a country, and you have already failed at getting what it is you actually want, and had no idea that there was a choice to get the thing you did get, it complicates things. And I remember walking back thinking, my gosh, what did we do? I don't know where Carol felt that. I'm sure she felt that often too. But that was the moment when I thought, this is going to be very, very hard if we can't even get bottled water. And by the way, I only drink seltzer water now. I drink nothing but seltzer water. But that happened, you know, 7 years after that experience, not not in that moment. So we lived in an apartment, the first apartment we had just behind Bezerovka. It was a very nice one-bedroom apartment. It was a temporary apartment. And from our apartment, we could see Lenin. This is Taras Shevchenko Boulevard. It's a gorgeous boulevard that runs out past the circus. And we lived not too far off of here later in our permanent apartment. But when you stood in our kitchen, you could see Lenin. And I thought, I remember thinking, wow, this part is kind of cool, right? There's Lenin. This is so like post-Soviet, and we're kind of in the middle of it. That was not the moment when we had, you know, had the Gazovada, but that apartment, that looking down at Lenin really was kind of the first moment of realizing this is a very different landscape than what I've been used to before. So we lived at 8 Gorkho Street. I'm not going to, believe me, this is not your aunt's, your uncle's slideshow where I show you every single thing we did for 10 months, but I want to give you just some general pictures, so please don't be afraid. So we lived, as you can see, I also figured out some things on PowerPoint, so I'm quite proud of the two arrows. I spent a lot of time working on that. So we had a one-bedroom apartment up there and a balcony, very nice. Downstairs, we had a casino, and we never went in there, as far as I know. I didn't. Carol made it, but we didn't go in there. But it was this strange kind of combination of apartment building and casino. This was our living room, and it was sort of tight quarters, but the boys were small enough that it didn't feel too cramped in there. I think it was most cramped when we would get into our bedroom at night, and Elijah was in a crib, and Benjamin and Toby were in a pull-out bed, and Carol and I were in the double. Was it a double? It was a double. So it wasn't a lot of room, and typically one or two or three of them would wind up climbing out of whatever place they were sleeping and wind up in bed with us. And so it was very tight quarters, especially during the winter when there wasn't a whole lot that we could do to move around outside. And that's just a cute picture. So that was, it's a cute picture, but that bit of garland, I put that in there for a reason, because Carol came back from being down in the subway station when this was right at Christmas time, just after Christmas. I think we were getting ready for New Year's, which is a very, very big celebration in Ukraine. And you can buy all sorts of very, very strange things in the underground passages. It's things sold off of boxes, and you know, people who bring a little bag and they open it up, and people are smoking like crazy all throughout there. And so Carol brought this home and put it on, or one of the boys put it on, and I walked by it, and it was the most unbelievable smell of cigarette smoke on that garland hat that he had on. And so there, you know, Benjamin and Elijah are dancing around with it, and I'm, you know, thinking, man, I can't stand the stink on that. But anyway, so most of the cuteness, but again, just one of those strange things. Okay. Pani Lita, this woman here, Pani Lita Danilova, was a very important part of our experience there, and I'm going to say why in just a second. First of all, she made these traditional Ukrainian shirts for each of the boys. This is when they all fit in them. This one, or maybe it's Benjamin's, now fits on Silas, who wore it at our Christmas party, Ukrainian Christmas party. But what we realized pretty quickly was, wow, we are going to need some help, because one of the first times we went shopping, we went and we saw what looked like a box of instant oatmeal. Okay, so you can imagine that, Quaker instant oats or whatever. Brought it back, very excited. Here's something that, you know that we can make that's going to work just right. And it turns out it's actually turkey stuffing. Right, instant turkey stuffing. Nothing on the box indicated. There's no, well, of course in Ukraine, there's no Thanksgiving scene or anything like that. But again, one of those moments where, like, well, we can't even walk into a store and go up to something that looks like something familiar and walk away with it and know, well, at least we, you know, nailed breakfast today. We didn't. Well, unless you like having savory stuffing for breakfast, we had not nailed breakfast. So Pani Lita was someone who someone at the Fulbright office knew, and she had been a chemist in her Soviet working life, and then after the Soviet Union collapsed, you know, she didn't have a job. There were the only jobs that were available literally were not pay jobs. There were jobs where you'd barter, you'd get, you know, something and you could exchange with it in the worst moments right after independence. So she came and worked with us. I mean, she didn't work for us, believe me. She came and helped with food. She helped with Elijah. Carol worked at the Fulbright office for the year, and I had taught, so I needed some time to prepare, which may be a surprise to those of you who had me in class. But so she helped out with those things, and really more than anything, I mean, I think she helped me survive. I think she helped Carol survive, but I'll speak for myself. Helped me survive because she helped us navigate so many of the difficult moments that we experienced throughout that 10 months. She cooked incredible food, but she also, I ate borscht every morning for breakfast all through winter. None of us was ever sick. And it's incredible how a diet like that with borscht and not very much processed food, you can stay fairly healthy. But she was also, like many Ukrainians, very concerned about being proactive in health. So Elijah, who's slightly fair-skinned, when we got there, Pani Lita determined that Elijah actually was suffering from some vitamin deficiency, and so therefore needed to have something, some food, to fix that. And you should know at that time that bird flu was a real concern. It did wind up down in, I think, in Crimea. There were some cases in Turkey while we were there. But it was one of our real concerns that bird flu could be a problem. So Pani Lita said that she wanted to buy some quail eggs and feed Elijah raw quail eggs to get him the vitamins that he needed. And we thought, well, no, you know, raw quail eggs probably not going to work for him, certainly not going to work for us. But those were those moments where, you know, she saw something and she wanted to address it and sort of make sure that we were healthy. She protected us too. Benjamin got hit by a car, not badly. I mean, it was turning on a street, but you know, scary enough in a foreign country. And so Pani Lita went charging down there. Carol called me up and say that had happened. I was with the other two boys, and the woman, as I understand it from Carol, was not necessarily inclined to hang around. And Pani Lita made that woman not only drive them to the American Medical Center, but sit in the waiting room, and then pay for the bill. And that was all Pani Lita. I mean, it wasn't Carol saying, you know, this, that, or the other thing. It was just Pani Lita, just, you are going to do this. You're going to take us there. And that's the way she was. She could also break walnuts in her hands. And that's not an exaggeration. I mean, in one hand, excuse me, just to be clear, one hand. And, you know, it was a very sad situation for her because her husband had been the pilot for the first secretary of the of Ukrainian Socialist Party, and then when he had lost that job, or that when the Soviet Union disbanded, that was no longer in existence. He got hit by a car and was basically incapacitated. So she was the only one who could work, and she was taking care of him, but she was taking care of us. And she's an incredible person. This is what I mean about the extremes. This was one of the most amazing people that any of us has ever been around, and we love her, and I want for the boys to see her, especially Elijah, but that hasn't happened yet. She used to call Elijah her little philolog, because Elijah has apparently quite the ability to pick up on language, and so Elijah was 20 months on for, you know, those 10 months, 20 to just short of 3, and Pani Lita spent 10 months talking to Elijah in Ukrainian. I had no idea what she was saying to him. I don't think any of the rest of us had any idea what she was saying to him. And at the end of our time there, she could say to Elijah, she would tell him a string of things, and he would go and do several different tasks around the apartment because he understood Ukrainian. It was amazing. And the story that really, Elijah loves the story, but the best story about that was one day she had been cleaning up something and had left a little bucket of water, a bucket with a little bit of water in it. And Elijah was playing and he stumbled backward and he dropped his bottom into the cold water. And his Elijah responded by saying, Holodna Vedichka, which we were not talking about that to him. That was the first thing he said to us. And I may be wrong about this, but what we understood was that meant a little bit of cold water. So he had gotten it right, you know? And that had all happened without us knowing. It was all between Panilita and Elijah. And it should also be said that Panilita used to chase Elijah around the house, the apartment, with like a piece of chicken cutlet on a fork, trying to get him to eat. Because it was crucial for her to put some meat on his bones. And whether it was by little pieces of chicken on a fork putting butter on a cookie. The boys came back thinking that's what you had. You ate cookies. You had a little bit of butter on top of your cookie. Which is basically to say have a little butter on your butter. Anyway, she was. I'm pausing on her because she is one of the great things about our experience. And again, what are the things you come away with when you have an experience like this? And I know that Pete and Carol have friends from their travels in Russia, but Panilita was one of those very important people. A couple other things that we found out when we were there. First of all, it's the only place I've ever been where you get milk in a bag. See, it's funny, they laugh. Because we remember what it's like to open up a bag of milk and then figure, okay, well now what do you do with it, right? Because we had our cereal and now we have 20 ounces left to go. And there would be bags and bags at the gastronome that we'd have to choose from. Okay. Before I talk about the boys' schooling, I do want to tell one quick story. And this is not to laugh at Ukraine, but is to say this is how different some things were. Carol went to pay the electricity bill for the first time early up, obviously, in our stay. And she went, you had to go to the bank. There are no checks in Ukraine, so you have to pay cash. She went to the bank and waited online, brought the bill and brought the money and handed it. Let's just say it was 50 hryvnia that she had and the amount was 47.45 or something like that. So she went up and paid. Short version, she could not get change back in the bank. She had to go outside to get exact change by buying something at the kiosk outside, getting the change, coming back into a bank to pay the bank with exact change the amount of the bill. Now, that story still to me is that moment of, okay, here's where we are, here's what we expect in life, and here's something extremely different. And there were many other things like that. But again, you know, what do you do with that? Well, that was, by the way, not a customer service moment. Because in Ukraine, customer service, that's not, I don't think that's a concept that most Ukrainians who work in the banks or gastronomes or restaurants, that's not familiar to them like it would be for us. Okay, this is just a picture of the boys standing in front of their Ukrainian schools. When we got there, we decided that we were going to do the right thing, and we were going to put our boys into a Ukrainian public school without any language skills. They didn't speak Russian. They didn't speak Ukrainian, but we figured, you know, they're sponges, so they're probably going to be able to pick it all up somehow. I mean, that's about how I understood it. And so they both wound up going to a second grade and a kindergarten public school in Ukraine. But it took Carol 6 weeks to get them into one of those schools. And again, this is one of those moments where you come up against the kind of bureaucracy that we had never seen before. And so for 6 weeks, she was chasing around to the central school administration people. She'd go to specific schools and try and get all of this worked out and look like it was going to work out, and then it would all blow apart. And the way that this kept blowing apart was that there was a law that said that basically the boys could go to school there. They were living in the country and they could go to school at a Ukrainian public school. So what the woman who Carol dealt with said was, I won't say yes and I can't say no. Period. So it left us nowhere. And there was not a whole lot we could do because she wasn't telling us no, but she wasn't allowing it to happen either. So it took a long time for us to get to the point where they actually got in school. And we wound up taking them to to a school that was about a 30-minute trip across town, where we went by a marshrutka, which I'll show you in a minute. It's a small bus. And then these trolley buses, which we were told were called Brezhnev buses, the electrified buses. It was difficult to get them there every morning. They were across town once they were there, and we were, you know, at a distance from them. But that trip took us by Sofia Cathedral, which is one of the oldest ones, maybe the oldest one in Ukraine, no, I guess Lavra. Absolutely stunning, beautiful square. You can see this picture on the right gives you a little bit better sense of just how big that space is. So every day we'd walk past this, and walk back past this statue of Bogdan Khmelnytskyi, and they'd get on their marshrutka, which is like a bus that you can get on and off wherever you want to get off, typically driven by a very angry man who was really, again, 7 years, 8 years later, it's funny. It wasn't funny then. Typically didn't want to stop, didn't want to let you on, didn't want to let you off. And once you got on with very small children, would mash the pedal to the floor so that everyone went shooting to the back of the marshrutka. I mean, it was a truly, those were difficult experiences. And it's really bad, by the way, when you realize, gosh, I have no idea how to tell this person I need to stop here. And the way I used to get off was to wait for somebody else to get off. And the first time that didn't happen, and I think it was Benjamin, and I'm thinking, how am I gonna, and so the way I finally figured out to do it was like, hey! And that was it, he stopped. But that was about the extent of it. And then here's a trolley bus, which that's a very new looking one compared to the ones we were on. I mean, the ones we were on felt like they had been driven every single day since 1977. Now, I'm not sure you can really see this with the light, but this is Zloty Voroda, which is the Golden Gate. This is reconstructed from one of the old gates to the old city of Kyiv. It's the oldest city in Ukraine. And we used to walk by this every day. So there were lots of unpleasant things. It was cold often, but boy, we had a very, very lovely set of things to see. The experience for school was bad for Toby, good for Benjamin. And that was really due in large part to the differences in their teachers. Benjamin had a kindergarten teacher who was very kind to him and very sympathetic and wanted to try and help him experience something positive in a Ukrainian school. Toby's teacher was much more interested in Toby not being a problem and not being a headache. So he would sit in the back. He would be left alone. She wouldn't really do much except fuss at you every once in a while if you didn't do something that you had no idea that you were supposed to have done. Carol had, I think that was probably your first student-teacher conferences, weren't they? In a different language. And they're they're frightening in a good language. So, I mean, the same language. So that was very hard. And the thing that was interesting is we didn't really understand how much Toby was struggling, not struggling academically, but just struggling to be at this school, because we learned a lot about both of them in this trip. Benjamin didn't really know how well he was going to do in this experience in an entirely different world, in a place where no one spoke his language. He did great. Toby, we came to find out, he didn't want to tell us that things were going badly, because he knew how much Carol had worked to get him into the school. And so it wasn't until Christmas break when we found out that he was really miserable and that he was being picked on. All the kids in that school were kids from 2nd to 11th grade in the same building. And the bathroom was on the first floor, and I think the second graders were on, the fourth? They were one of the higher. So Toby had to go. If he had to go to the bathroom, he had to go downstairs to the first floor by himself, sometimes run a little line of 7th, 8th, 9th, 10-year-olds or 10th graders who wanted to mess with him, and then go back up. In so many ways, he was really having a hard time, and he didn't want to say anything because he didn't want us to be disappointed or didn't want Carol to feel like, you know, well, you worked, did all this work, and but I don't want to do this. So we finally figured out what was going on, and Toby had been very stoic. He wound up going to a Turkish international school that was actually a one-hour drive from our apartment, and he got on a bus, and it was, I mean, it was a one-hour drive, not lots of stops that made it 1 hour of distance. And again, he did it without, I mean, he must have been scared. And I don't think we wanted to ask too much because we knew what we needed to do. But very brave, and he did it. So when things started to seem like they were not going to be great every second of our time in Ukraine, we decided that we were going to go to the opera and the ballet a lot. This is the opera house in Kyiv. It's about 5 blocks from where we lived. And the key to this was the tickets for the opera and the ballet were $2, which is mind-blowing. I grew up in New York City, and I want to take the boys to see things in New York City. And if I wanted to take our family to go see an opera at the Met, unless I got very lucky to get those extremely small number of cheap tickets, it would be $300-$400. So to be able to bring everybody for $8 or $10 was remarkable, and it was incredible. It was, the quality was wonderful. And little story about that, the first time Benjamin came back from an opera, after his first opera, they were very skeptical that they were going to enjoy this, and they actually loved both the operas and the ballets. And of course, Toby had his first ballet lesson in Kyiv, and those of you who know us or know Toby, he wound up continuing to do ballet up until last year, and that's where that all began. But after Benjamin saw Carmen, he said, "Mommy, I never realized opera was so cool." which is a pretty good outcome, actually, if you think about it. So they saw Carmen, they saw Nutcracker, they saw Rigoletto, Swan Lake, Aida, all for $2. Well, Nutcracker was 40 cents. So that's, we focused a lot on this, and it really helped us through some of the darker times. I wanted to show you a few other places that we visited. This is a castle in western part of the country near Lviv, and as you can see, here's Toby not totally excited about being there. I think at that point he was getting pretty tired, and I'm also looking pretty cold. But this building along here, this is where in 1939 the NKVD, which was the precursor of the KGB, murdered all of the political prisoners who were there right before the Germans. They were being held in this building right before the Germans came. And there was a display and something of a museum in there. And that was really the first moment in my life that I'd ever been any place where that was had that kind of World War II history connected to it. Okay, so you know, this is my first experience with spaces where atrocities were committed. And I had not really known that was what we were going to find there. I knew we were going to find this castle under the hill, it's called. Beautiful place, but not that story. We went to Yalta at the end of our time, right before we came back to the States. And this is Levadia, which is where Stalin and Roosevelt and Churchill met in 45. Absolutely gorgeous place. Yalta is in a remarkable place because if you look one way, it looks like the French Riviera. And if you turn the other way, it looks like you're in Scotland, in the Highlands. Remarkable place. And we had a chance to walk all through Levadia. Now this was I actually put this up for 2 reasons. One, because it's, for those of you who know me, me looking a little goofy with the hat on, all the boys wearing it better. But also because I was terrified about going up to this place. This was the trip that we went all the way up the mountain. I Petri is the highest mountain in the Crimea, and all of these very narrow, windy roads. And we got up there, and that's probably the only time I was smiling during that whole experience. We got up there, and I wanted to get back from there. And again, at that moment, you know, camels were not comforting to me. That didn't help calm me. Especially because about 2 months earlier, we'd gone to Egypt with the boys and thought, let's get the boys pictures on a camel. They're going to love this. This is going to be fantastic. And that was a total catastrophe. No one wanted anywhere near a camel. They were big and terrifying. Did you wind up going up on a camel? So anyway, this was a very, but it was an interesting place because this was, you know, one of those very few little pockets of Tatar culture that are left in the Crimea, and the Tatars were pushed out of Crimea during by Stalin and have come back in pockets, but this was an opportunity to see something that's not many get to see. And then here's Ipetri looking back from the mountain down towards the Black Sea and Yalta. That's, by the way, the summer. It was freezing. They were, and then down at the other end, here we are, or the boys are at the Black Sea. Okay, so let me say briefly a little bit about my experience teaching, and then I'm going to wrap up by saying a few things about Maidan. Teaching is not the same across or all around the world. The first thing I knew was going to be different about teaching in Ukraine was when I discovered that no one at my university, when I first met with them, 2 weeks before I thought the beginning of the semester was going to happen, no one seemed to know what I was going to teach, nor when my class would begin. And I didn't know any of that information until the night before my class began. So for all of us in here who teach every semester, imagine getting a phone call at about 7:30 at night, hey, just wanted to let you know, tomorrow at 8, your class is going to begin. That was how I found out that I was going to start teaching. That was a little bit strange. A second thing that's very different about teaching in Ukraine, I've not had the experience when I teach of having every student, when I walk in the room, stand up. Now, if you've had that happen, I may be doing something wrong, but the first time I walked into class and everybody stood, I thought, wow, they liked the American or something, but that's what happens in every class. That wasn't the truth. That's what happens in every class. And that's a very nice thing. Now, what also seems to happen is that sometimes they sit back down and they do homework for whatever other classes they're taking and don't pay attention to you the rest of the time. I also experienced that. But there are things that I found out I would never have been able to imagine that caused real problems. So the second class session I ever taught there, I went up on a Tuesday. I taught the first Tuesday. And I showed up in my classroom. And no one was there. And, you know, it's 8:30 class or something like that. And I'm sitting there. It's 8:35, 8:40. I'm thinking, I don't know what's happened here. Something clearly has happened here. Maybe they just decided to cancel my class or something like that. Probably had fewer than 8 students. No, okay, fine. And I went upstairs to find the dean, no dean, and left. I mean, I didn't know what to do. I had no idea what was happening. So later that day, I got a phone call from the dean, mad. I mean, not diplomatic, not, well, let's give this guy a mulligan. Just ticked off. And what it turned out happens, at least in that university, and I think it happened in a lot of universities in Ukraine, every week you change classrooms. And you have to go to a board to find out what classroom you teach in. I mean, who would intuit that, right? You wouldn't think that's the case. Well, why might you do that? One of the reasons you might do that is, it was explained to me at least there, because if the rector doesn't like the way you teach, then you just don't have a classroom. You just erased from the board. So it's a measure of control. But I had no clue that anything like that happened anywhere in the world. So she understood me as being this kind of delinquent, you know, who just didn't really care about teaching, so I'd show up every now and then. And I'm thinking, this is an explanation I could never have possibly imagined. And she lit into me. I mean, she was all over me. At the end, she said, higher education is the same all around the world. And that was the end of the conversation. So that wasn't a lot of fun. I mean, be honest with you, because she came into my class, I guess it was a week later, and she explained what had gone on and explained it in a pretty ugly way. And then I had, you know, another 12 weeks with the class. I didn't teach there the second semester. That comes as a surprise. I went to another university. So that experience, some good students. It was clear to me I didn't have to worry about grading because they were going to do that for me. Truly. I mean, I didn't have to worry about the final grades because all of that had been determined sometime before the class began. And that's true, too, because people paid good money to go to that university and they were not going to have an American mess that up. The second semester that I taught there, I taught at a place called Kyiv Slavonic University. That complete opposite, total other side of the spectrum. I had to, when I, the guy who I coordinated all this with, he would not take no for an answer when he said, I want to come in, or I want to have you picked up at your apartment every day you teach and driven to the university, which was a reasonable 20-minute walk. I mean, I wasn't going to Peoria. It was just a nice little walk down the street. No, 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 we've got to bring you. You're the professor from America. We've got to bring you over. And that was the experience of that the whole time that I taught that semester, that, you know, we are happy to have you here. It's special to have you here. You're a Fulbrighter, all of this. And I felt really, I mean, it's very nice. Believe me, after the first semester, it was very nice. And it was my first day teaching there it was symptomatic of that treatment. I was taken into the rector's office, the president's office, and I've got a class of students waiting for, let's say, an 11:30 class. And the president wants to say hello. This is my second semester, so I knew that saying hello usually meant some vodka and maybe some caviar and some cold cuts and some things. So we sit down, and it's maybe 11:15, and he starts talking. He signs his book that he's written. He's a historian. He gives it to me, and I'm getting all this to the translator, and would you like cognac? Do you want some vodka? And I don't want either, but I have to have some. It's 11:30. We keep talking. It continues. It's 11:45. He wants to know a little bit more about what I'm going to do when I go back and what kind of classes might I teach if I came back again. And I mean, on and on and on. Couldn't stop. Just continued. So it's about 12 o'clock. And at that point, probably we'd had two shots of vodka, which was very, very tame compared to a conference I went to. And I'm thinking, well, surely the class is gone, right? 30 minutes. No one is waiting 30 minutes here for a faculty member at Eureka or any place that I ever taught. There they all are. They're all sitting there just waiting for the American professor to come in, all shoot up, and we just start class. You know, and I have a head full of vodka. But, you know, it just... Those things are so incredibly different. And I would never know myself that things like that could exist, that if someone came here and expected those things, you would never know. You would never know that people had lived, you know, taught in those kinds of circumstances. Okay. There are plenty of others which I'm not going to share now, but I do want to mention one other thing. I had the opportunity to lecture at, I think it was 12 universities around Ukraine. And this is something that really is amazing to me still. At every one of those lectures, and I was lecturing on Henry James, and that's not a big draw typically. You're going to have a lot of empty seats all around you. I went to Lviv, to a university in Lviv, and that place, 250 people were in that room for me to talk about late Henry James, which usually is a punishment. They wanted to hear it. I talked about Poe in Rivne, 200 students there. Every place I went, that building, the buildings were packed. I went to Estonia, and Tartu, and Tallinn, same kind of thing. This is not a slam on anybody in this room or on American education at all. It's just so radically different when you go and people are desperate to hear you talk about literature. That was a good experience to have. I like that a lot, actually. Okay, so to go on, and Maidan here is this is the transition point to sort of the current moment. And I just want to say, I simply want for the people in this room to walk out of here and wonder a little bit more about what's happening in Maidan. I don't want you to be pro-government, anti-government, or anything like that, but just that you would at least leave here and find out a little bit more about what the struggle is about and what is happening after almost 80 days of Maidan, which is Independence Square in Kyiv, being occupied by anti-government protesters. Okay, this is 2005. So this is when we were there. This is Carol's picture of Maidan. This is the central square in all of Ukraine. It's kind of it's an epicenter of activity. It was the site of the Orange Revolution. They went back for the celebration. There are the two transplanted Ukrainians, Benjamin and Toby, celebrating hard. That was a very joyful and hopeful moment, because at that point, it seemed like Ukrainians had captured the rights and the freedoms that they had hoped to capture. Yanukovych had lost. Yushchenko had won. Democracy was on its way. That all started to crumble pretty quickly when we were there, actually, when the government that won that election started to come apart. So very quickly, and I'm not an expert on all this, but I want to just give you some major figures. This is the man who won the election in 2005, Viktor Yushchenko. The picture on the left is him before the elections, before the campaign. He was poisoned at some point during the campaign, and then his face was disfigured like this. Never proven, but a lot of people believed at the time that the person or the one behind the poisoning was Viktor Yanukovych. Viktor Yanukovych is the president right now. If you had said to us in 2005, Viktor Yanukovych will be the president again, that would have been incomprehensible. No way. Because he was the bad guy. He was the one who tried to steal the election in 2005. They did the Orange Revolution. They took over Maidan. They won the right for a re-election. And Yanukovych won, and so did democracy. So goodbye to Yanukovych. Didn't happen that way. Yulia Tymoshenko, some of you may have seen her. Her hair is a very famous feature for those people who are aware of what goes on in Eastern Europe. She was the prime minister after the Orange Revolution. There she is with Yushchenko. They were a very strong team. They were strong leaders during the Orange Revolution. And then soon after that, within 8 months maybe, that partnership really broke down and Tymoshenko left and Yushchenko was without a prime minister. And in a story that sadly is very Ukrainian in its trajectory, Yushchenko wound up getting Yanukovych as the prime minister after Tymoshenko. So the guy who had allegedly poisoned him and who had tried to steal the election wound up becoming the prime minister. And that's that's the president right now. Yes, I put him in a picture with Lenin for a reason. That's not the only picture I could find on the internet, because I think for a lot of people, this is the struggle right now, that Yanukovych in Ukraine he wants to be a Putin guy. He has been a Putin guy. And he wants to draw Ukraine away from the EU and towards Russia. That also means that, at least, if you see it one way, that what he wants is a police state. And there is a lot of video on YouTube and the Twitter and the Facebook and all those things. You can find video of what a police state really looks like. The Berkut, which is the riot police on November 30th, January 16th, several different moments during the course of the last 2.5 months when the police have decided to rush the protesters and try and disperse them. And, ugly scenes of literally 10, 15 Berkut policemen running by in riot gear and people on the ground and just continuing to beat them and kick them as they go. And there are lots of stories about. I'm not going to go into those stories. You should look for yourself. But the point is that the Ukrainians right now are trying to fight against the creation of an even more draconian police state than exists in Russia, and one that looks a whole lot more like Lukashenko's Belarus. So if you haven't seen any of these pictures, the picture I showed before, the first anniversary, that's essentially the same angle, but that's now the barricades, one of the barricades that exists on Maidan. You cannot drive through Maidan anymore, which is a large street. It's several lanes in both ways, in both directions. Imagine Times Square in New York being completely shut down, that no one could get through unless you were allowed through. And that's what the protesters who are fighting for, fighting against Yanukovych, fighting to be part of the European Union, they have created these barricades to create a space for, the democracy movement, if you will. And here's another picture of Maidan barricade. Hrushevskoye is a second place that has become a major battleground in Ukraine, in Kyiv right now. January 16th, the president, meaning Yanukovych, the president passed a law about anti-protest laws. One of the features, or two of the features of the protest movement this time through is that most of the protesters have worn some kind of helmet so that if they are beaten by the police, their heads are safe, and they've worn masks so their identities are safe. January 16th, they pass a bill in Ukraine that no longer allows protesters in a peaceful protest to wear any kind of mask. And if you wear a mask, you serve 15 days in jail. You're not allowed to wear a helmet. If you wear a helmet, you serve 15 days in jail. You're not allowed to block access to a residential building. Well, guess what? There are residential buildings all around Rzeszowskoe and Maidan. And these are, by the way, Rzeszowskoe is right around the corner from Maidan. So this is all the same general area of Ukraine, or Kyiv. Block access to a residential building, 6 years in jail. Block access to a government building. By the way, the police here, that's the Berkut. They're lined up there, and at different moments, there have been thousands, not hundreds of them. They're blocking the way up the route towards the parliament. Blocking access to a government building, 5 years in jail. The Berkut and the Militia, which are the two police organizations that have been running, that Yanukovych has been running, have been granted immunity or amnesty for crimes committed against protesters. So needless to say, and there's more things to this law, needless to say, protesters who are the target of that law, not pleased with that. And what happens is Rzeszowskoe winds up blowing up. And the police set up on one side, the protesters set up barricades, they burn tires, they pull up every cobblestone in the street, and it becomes a pitched battle for several weeks. That barricade is made of bags full of snow. Behind that barricade is the Fulbright building. So part of the reason why this is heartbreaking for us is because this is a world that we went through every single day. We knew what this place is like. We knew the people who were in there. And part of it's because of people like Pani Lita who are fighting for basic rights. I mean, this is the world they're living in right now, just to have the right to protest. This is the Dynamo Kyiv Stadium, which is a central piece of Ukrainian football lore in Ukraine, and it has been basically destroyed and been the site of a battle that has been raging now for 3 weeks. And this is the last picture I'm going to show you. The protesters set up tire barricades and they lit them on fire, and those tires were on fire for a long period of time. This is the Dynamo Stadium. This building right here is the Fulbright office, and we used to look across the street at this building from the Fulbright. It's now illegal to carry tires to the protest. I was just reading a story about a man who has two young children, and he is facing up to 6 years in jail for having carried tires to the protest because they were going to be lit on fire and part of this whole movement. So I'm going to leave it at that. And again, I wanted you to see at least and hear a little bit if you had not heard about what's going on in Kyiv right now. It's a battle over whether or not Ukraine goes towards the European Union, which is what they had wanted to do until Yanukovych chose to not sign an important association agreement in that process in November. And Yanukovych wanting to create a police state that's totalitarian and at this moment in time, my hope is that the totalitarian version doesn't win and people win. That's what I want to see. But you have to make a decision for yourself, but I hope you will at least look for that. So thank you for starting with the cute and ending with the grim, and for being here to hear about Ukraine.
Sure, absolutely. Phil has time for questions, if anybody has questions.
Shopping and burnout in the bus. I don't understand.
So I guess I left out the part about my stubborn self-reliance. I mean, that's true. I think it was, right. And that's, I think that was available to us. For example, when we first got there, second, third day, Martha said, Carol was trying to figure out, how do we get the boys into a school? This is like our third day on the ground. And the woman who's the Fulbright director said, whoa, how about if I have Adik take you to get some groceries? So I think part of it was that I was not, I'm not going to talk about Carol, not asking for some of the things that might have been available. Now, should people have, you know, said, we're going to be there on Monday morning and we're going to take you around and do all that? That's what my university was supposed to have done. But they did not. But, well, I think there's a combination of that. But again, what do you learn about yourself when you travel? One of the things I learned about myself when I travel is that, like, that whole thing about not asking for directions. Yeah, I am very bad at that. I'm not good at asking for help. And so there were moments when I couldn't muddle through it. And I needed help and I didn't get it. But Carol was the one who was willing to ask for help at times and did ask for help. But you're right, Pete. I mean, there were some moments there you think, weren't we supposed to get more support than this? But no, that's, thank you for bringing that up. It's something I dropped off here in the interest of time, but I did not have any problems in any of my lectures talking to any of my students. Now, there may have been some moments when they didn't get it all, but I would teach 45 students. It was, they were in the faculty of linguistics, which is to say they were, basically they were majoring in languages, and these were students who were fully fluent in English, so I did not need a translator. Now, in other parts of the country, I would have. But in Kyiv, my students, they understood. And we would have conversations. This was not me lecturing. This was a dialogue. And you know, that's, when I left, I had seen a student my last semester at Catawba who was asking for an exemption from a language requirement because his doctor said he was incapable of learning a second language. Now, this is not to say there aren't learning disabilities or any of that, but when I got back from Ukraine, I thought, well, gosh, I mean, how could you possibly live in Ukraine if you can only learn one language? Because if you only spoke Russian in your house, the language of instruction in school was Ukrainian. So you need a second one just to go through school. And most people knew a third, at least some, English. And actually, there was a moment when a student who knew French, but we were struggling in English, we were able to clarify something in French. It was a fourth language this 19-year-old student had. So I didn't have that problem. But imagine having someone from any other country come to one of our classes with our students and speak in any language other than English. I mean, it's hard to imagine getting together a group of students who could manage a 200 or 300 level course like that. Morgan. Panilita? I'm not. Honey Lita is the hard one. We got her email when we left, and at a certain point, it stopped working, and so we have not been in contact with her. Now, if we go back, we could probably get a hold of her through the Fulbright office, and I'm sure people, all the Fulbright folks that we knew are still there. I mean, the office folks are still there. So, but that has been something I do grieve about that, because I'd like for her to see the boys. Boys, come here, just one second. I just want, just so that everybody can see that you're not that size anymore. I mean, they are different. Come here. You know, and so for Panilita, you know, Elijah's 10 now. Benjamin's 13, Toby's 16. And so Toby was 2 years younger than Elijah is now. So there's a lot of change, and I wish that she could see that. And I did promise her at our last dinner together that that I wanted to bring them back when they were teenagers and be able to speak to her in Ukrainian. Now, neither of those things have happened yet because I could take them back, I couldn't speak in Ukrainian. Apparently Toby had a beautiful Ukrainian accent, or he spoke Ukrainian beautifully when he had to recite Taras Shevchenko poems. But I don't think they were, any of them remember Ukraine. You guys can sit down. I don't want to stand here. So. I don't think they came away with the Ukraine. And part of it is because, in Toby's case, that would have been the best opportunity because everyone else around him was learning Ukrainian. But that teacher chose to say, just go over there in the corner, which was unfortunate. Elijah? If I wanted to see the Soviet Union, why didn't I go to Russia? That's from Elijah. oh, that's a good question. Well, partly because that would have been a little bit harder, I think. Really, Russia would have been harder. We didn't have to register in Kyiv to, you know, we didn't have to register in other cities if we visited. What? It's a good question. I guess maybe a way to answer that, because it is a good question, is Moscow seemed too intimidating. And that would probably have been Moscow, St. Petersburg. Because we had such small kids, we had to be someplace where there was, you know, the medical care that we needed. But I couldn't imagine going to Moscow. Kyiv, naive as we were, seemed like that was going to be pretty manageable. And, you know, we managed it, but I'm not sure I'd call it manageable. Eric? Well, I think, Carrie, part of the answer to that is I've been watching daily video live streams from Ukraine, watching people standing up against, 1,000 riot police, and in some cases having very bad things come of it. And the European Union has, as far as I can tell, done very little, which is a bad thing. Now, is Putin going to play the way he's playing right now? Here's 15 million, no, I'm going to, or, you know, 15 billion, I'm going to bring it back and all that. Yeah, he's going to do that. But right now, it seems like he's in charge. He's in control. He's got Sochi, which is good. He's got Yanukovych in Sochi, which is goofy in a lot of ways. But the EU does not seem to have a strong counter to whatever Putin is doing. And by the way, I don't mean that Putin's, doing this. I just mean straight up, who's going to give the money so that the hryvnia, which is at like 9 hryvnia to a dollar, was 4.8 when we were there. I mean, the economy's getting crushed. I would like for the answer, Harry, to be that the EU is going to step up and it's going to put the pressure on that allows Ukraine at least to have new elections. I don't see it happening right now, but they're still in the square. Renee. Because you know that's what should happen in your heart, but it doesn't? Right. Well, I think part of the answer to that is that truly, a lot of Ukrainian students grew up learning a certain American literature. So they learn about Theodore Dreiser. For instance, there's a Theodore Dreiser Street in Ukraine. I'm just telling my class about this. They learn about Carl Sandburg and Lindsay and other poets from the early part of the 20th century. I don't know very many graduate students who ever read any of those poets. Not that they're not good poets, it's just, it's a canon of writers that really is not what's read right now if you look at an anthology. So Henry James would be in that category. When I talked about Marianne Moore, T.S. Eliot, William Carlos Williams, I was talking with them about poets that they maybe had heard of, but they'd never read. And I think with someone like Henry James, it's a very similar thing. Now, the second part of that is, anytime I talked about a poet or an author where linguistic sophistication, nuance, experimentation was part of what that person was doing, a lot of people wanted to be there because it's the stuff that doesn't make it through translation. So if you read a poem that is really about linguistic experimentation in translation, chances are you've lost a bunch of what was going on there. And I think that's part of it as well. So I've read Henry James in Russian or Ukrainian, but I don't get it in the same way that I might, because the language isn't coming through the way it needs to in a book that's not very much about plot and very much about the style and form. But that may not be it. I mean, there's a real intellectual curiosity, too, there that's different. So, all right, thank you.
Please join us at a reception out in Moser Lobby immediately following, and I'm sure if you have additional questions, Dr. Cavalier can answer those. I'd also like to invite you to attend the next Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture, March 20th at 7:30, The Bible According to Musical Theater, A Survey of Musicals That Use Scripture as Source Material. And that'll be presented by Associate Professor of Theater, Marty Lynch. Thank you, and good night.